Francois. It's my great pleasure to welcome you tonight to the delegation of the Ismaili Imamat for this lecture about the revitalization of the international headquarters of the Global Center for Pluralism at 330 Sussex Drive. We are thrilled to have as our distinguished speaker this evening Shirley Bloomberg of the award-winning Canadian firm KPMG Architects. At the outset, I would like to acknowledge that we are gathered on the traditional territory of the Algonquin people. This area, overlooking the confluence of the Ottawa and Gatineau rivers, is an historic meeting place of peoples, Indigenous, French and British, and today for Canadians from all corners of the globe. Built in 1905 for the Dominion Archives of Canada, and then home, as many of you remember, to the Canadian War Museum from 1967 to 2005, 330 Sussex Drive will officially open in the spring as the Global Center for Pluralism. The center was founded by two equal partners, His Highness the Aga Khan and the Government of Canada. His Highness has underwritten the restoration and renovation of the building, which has totaled approximately $35 million. This is a very rare case of a global philanthropist making a major investment in Canada's public architectural heritage. The center takes its inspiration from Canada's experience as a multicultural, very diverse, multi-ethnic country. Respect for diversity has become a core element of our identity. And as countries around the world become increasingly diverse, many are looking to Canada and asking what they can learn. Our definition of pluralism is really respect for diversity in society, and our thesis is that virtually all societies in the 21st century world, developed and developing countries, are diverse. And if that diversity is accommodated and valued, the result is more peaceful and prosperous societies. In the words of His Highness the Aga Khan, diversity is not a reason to put up walls, but rather to open windows. It is not a burden, it is a blessing. Notre siège social à Ottawa sera un centre mondial où auront lieu des conversations sur le pluralisme. Des spécialistes se rencontreront au centre pour discuter de la manière dont nos sociétés peuvent répondre plus positivement à la diversité. Nous partagerons des analyses sur la façon dont le pluralisme est abordé dans d'autres régions du monde. Des éducateurs se réuniront pour suivre des formations sur les approches d'enseignement du pluralisme à leurs étudiants. Ce soir, en nous penchant sur l'histoire de notre édifice, nous nous tournons également vers l'avenir. La restauration du 330 promenade Sussex a inspiré la création d'un plan de secteur pour transformer l'accessibilité à la rive et créer des sentiers pédestres et des pistes cyclables aux alentours. La Commission de la capitale nationale inclut ce plan dans ses plans pour la capitale. Et nous espérons que la restauration du 300 Sussex servirait de tremplin à la transformation de tout le secteur. And Shirley will tell us more about this exciting plan in a few moments. Now you may be wondering why we're not hosting this lecture in our new building. Well, the reason is pretty simple. Although the staff moved in a couple of weeks ago, some aspects of the restoration, especially the public spaces, will take some more time to complete. But the official opening is planned for the spring, and we look forward to having you visit our new building during visitors' hours, which will begin in June. Throughout the summer, you'll be most welcome to come on Wednesday evenings and Saturday afternoons. I'd like to just take a moment and thank the many partners who've contributed to this project. The NCC, the Federal Heritage Building Review Office, the City of Ottawa, KPMG, our architects, MP Lundy Construction, the design team under KPMG, including WSP Balso, Barry Podolsky, who's with us tonight, Smith and Anderson, Turner and Townsend, PFS Landscape Architects, together with John Chapagne, as well as many others. And I note, too, in particular, the very important contribution that Imara, 330 Sussex Drive, a group of senior members of the Ismaili community who have overseen the whole project. We are also very appreciative of the strong support of our neighbors, the National Gallery of Canada and the Royal Canadian Mint. And if you'll permit a commercial plug, our building will offer a unique destination for events, and so we encourage your organizations, government departments, corporations, NGOs, to consider renting spaces at the center as of June for your next event. We even have brochures at the back if you're interested. And finally, I'd like to thank His Highness Diplomatic Representative, Dr. Mahmoud Ibu, the delegation of the Ismaili Imamat, and the Aga Khan Foundation Canada for again providing these magnificent premises for the Phillips Memorial Lecture. We are just delighted to be partnering this evening with Heritage Ottawa, and it's now my very great pleasure to introduce Heritage Ottawa's president, David Jeans, who will introduce our lecture.
I'd actually like to start by offering, on behalf of Heritage Ottawa, a small token of our appreciation to the Global Centre for Pluralism, a book about the planning of the National Capital. So, we're going to your office. And now, I only have a couple of minutes, so I just have a couple of things to tell you. First of all, this year is the 50th anniversary of Heritage Ottawa, and each year we celebrate our founders, Bob and Marianne Phillips. There's a photograph of them on the table at the back that I hope some of you will have a chance to look at later. Bob Phillips was our first president back in 1967 was the founding year, but Bob as president and Marianne as the founding secretary were really indefatigable fighters for preserving our built heritage. And we're always very happy when their daughters are able to be with us, and two of the three are here tonight. Margaret and Jennifer are sitting second row from the back, and you can talk to them afterwards. They're just waving their hands right now. Bridget isn't here because she's working in England. But Bob Phillips made a huge contribution and was the founding executive director of what was then the Heritage Canada Foundation, today the National Trust, and a recipient of the Order of Canada. He was a member of the Order of Canada for his work in heritage. Next week is Heritage Week, and if you have time, drop by City Hall midday on Tuesday between 11 and 2. There's a celebration of Ottawa's historic societies, heritage organizations, museums, and so on. It's an exhibition well worth looking at. And in the evening, the city is celebrating the Architectural Conservation Awards, which this year, for the first time, include awards for heritage conservation, one of which will be received by Heritage Ottawa as an organization, and another will be received by one of our directors, Ken Elder, for his individual effort. And those events are both on Tuesday. Talk to me afterwards if you want more information. It's my task, as John said, to introduce Shirley Bloomberg tonight. I could talk for a long time, but you came here to hear her. She's a founding partner of KPMG Architects, as you see on the screen, and has many projects that touch on culture, particularly the cultural renaissance in Toronto. Some of her projects include the National Ballet School, the Gardner Ceramic Museum, and the Toronto International Film Festival, the TIFF Bell Lightbox, but also restorations of very important older heritage buildings, like the Design Exchange, which is one of my favorites, Art Deco building on Bay Street. She's a member of the President's Advisory Council for the Ontario College of Art and Design, and that's a pretty avant-garde place. I also have an interest in transportation, and she's designing the Jack Layton Ferry Terminal for the Toronto waterfront, and I'm going to talk to her about that afterwards. And she served on the City of Toronto Design Review Panel, etc., 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 not to mention being a member of the Order of Canada. So I'd like to now introduce Shirley Bloomberg, our featured speaker for tonight, and enjoy the evening.
Good evening. Bonsoir. Thank you all for coming out. This is really wonderful, and thank you particularly for your etc., etc., etc. It leaves much to the imagination. I'm delighted to be here tonight to talk about a project that my partner Bruce Kubar and I have been working on for some time, and one that's very dear to our hearts. This is a project that is, while it is a small project, it has huge ambition, and every so often in our careers comes a project, it's quite unusual, but this is one of them, that has a higher calling. So when we saw that the Imara was seeking proposals for the Global Center for Pluralism, we were very, very excited, and also incredibly excited about the mission of this institution, as John has explained. And for an architect, I think to look at converting over a century-old building into a contemporary global institution, particularly one with these kinds of ambitions in terms of research, education, dialogue, and respect for diversity, we were quite captivated with how we could, as architects, contribute to creating this. And for us, it seemed tremendously important, both in the forecourt, which we redesigned, and in the building, that this is essentially about dialogue and exchange between people. And how can we design an environment that would actually foster that, whether you're two people speaking in quiet conversation, a small group, or a large, we can't actually have as many people in our dialogue center as this, but a large group. This is the mission statement, and I think also as Canadians we could be can be extraordinarily proud that His Highness chose Canada. I think an excellent choice for this very, very important global institution. John and his team have been, even though they just moved in a couple of weeks ago, they've been hard at work over the years, and I've had the privilege of attending some of these annual lectures that they've done, and they are quite extraordinary. So I think they're already having quite an impact on our culture. So His Highness and the Government of Canada came together and selected this building, which was the original Dominion Archives building, built in 1906, then became the Canadian War Museum, and then after that moved into its new building, was sitting vacant for a number of years. In 1926, a new wing was added to the building, and when we started on the project, this is how we found the building. It was designed by David Hewitt, who in the finest tradition, Canadian tradition, came from Scotland, and he became the chief Dominion architect. And during his tenure, he actually oversaw 340 buildings. Isn't that extraordinary? So you can just imagine the kind of aspirations all over the country. Anyway, some of his finest buildings are here in Ottawa, and our building at the top, shortly thereafter, hot on the hills of the Archives building, he designed the Mint, the Victoria Memorial building, and the Connaught building as well. He was very fond of Tudor Gothic, and so all of this is presented to you in Tudor Gothic. My partner Bruce Kobara, a few years back, worked on the conversion with Barry Podolsky, who's here tonight, of the Victoria Memorial Building into the Museum of Nature. And as I'm sure all of you know, that used to have an 80-foot high tower which had to be started sinking and had to be taken down because of liquefaction in the soil. So that's what we've now, we were able to, in our renovation, to actually, now with superior technology, to actually build a new glass tower that recalls the original intent of David Hewitt. So we think he's probably pretty happy with that. So what we did before we submitted our proposal, Bruce and I came up and we walked all around the site, looked at the neighboring buildings, the National Gallery and the Mint, and then we took a taxi to the other side of the river. And we were kind of shocked, actually, It's the most extraordinarily beautiful, rugged riverscape. And you've got the House of Parliament just off to the right. And then in this section, it's really pretty undeveloped and not, a very undistinguished, let's say, response to such an extraordinary riverscape. And what we realized is that every building, including 330 Sussex, actually turned their back to the building, to the river. So that's the National Gallery, the Met, as well as our building, which I have to circle for you to show you where it is. You can hardly see it. So we spoke to that in our submission and put this photograph in, and then we were told later when we got the commission that His Highness had done exactly the same thing. And so I think that had resonated for him. And what is so extraordinary about the work that he and his foundation do around the world is that he's always looking at the context. So this was no exception. And after a lot of discussion, he said, we can't just rush in to design the building. We have to look at the context, because this is such an extraordinarily important undeveloped part of the riverscape in the city. And we don't want to, we want to make sure that when we design the Global Center for Pluralism, it doesn't prohibit any wonderful future plans and actually encourages the great opportunities that we thought were there. So he commissioned us with Ken Greenberg to study essentially from the Rideau Canal to Rideau Falls, this whole precinct, and to understand both the history and evolution and why we had this area, which was curiously here, somewhat suburban compared to how the city has developed around the rest of this area. So we started working on a scoping plan, then a master plan, and we very quickly noted from looking at the NCC's wonderful maps of the city, it became extremely obvious, and then we started talking about it as the missing link. You have a wonderful pedestrian pathway, but it's broken here. And you can understand why, because it's very, very steep there, and the soil is unstable. It's not the easiest thing to implement. So we became very interested in how we could complete this system and really bring this whole part of the river's edge into the kind of life and public consciousness of the city. Before Samuel de Champlain sailed up the river in the 17th century and for some time thereafter, this was really just, this area was an area where indigenous people and European settlers, traders, either passed through or did trade. And then in the 19th century, one of our neighbors to the south had the brilliant idea that this would actually make a very, very good forest industry. So that's what happened. And there's this wonderful, I love this, the Prince of Wales in Canada, His Royal Highness descending a timber slide at Ottawa. And this was in the Illustrated London News in 1860. I think that was very, very sporting of His Highness, really. His Royal Highness. But so it became a booming industrial commercial role, the river carried that role, as well as beautiful bucolic recreational role in the city. And Nepean Point, which is adjacent to our site, was originally beautifully forested. It then became, obviously, it's an incredibly important promontory in the city, in the life of the city. A great viewing point, great events location. And this was 1906. And in when we started working on the project, our building is here. This is the Mint, as you all know, and this is the National Gallery. What happened was, in the building of the National Gallery, that Lady Grey Drive no longer had any continuity. This wing cut off its connection to Nepean Point. And indeed, as everybody knows, Nepean Point has become relatively inaccessible compared to the role it played previously in the city. I love this too, picturesque Canada. This is the past, though. I think our building is part of our future. But it is quite delightful, and in addition to the fantastic view you get of Parliament Hill, they would fire the cannons on the Queen's birthday and other ceremonial occasions. So we started looking, and we realized that this was actually treated for the longest time almost as a kind of industrial site. You had the government printing bureau, you had the mint, which remains a manufacturing facility, and then you had the archives. And you had the sort of the finer fabric of the city developing. And this is what we have today, and you see some of that vestige still remaining. Lady Grey Drive, this is what it was in the 50s. And this is now, and what you see again is the back of the mint, the back of our building, excuse me, and this is the service yard for the National Gallery. The curatorial wing, they had amazing views up the river, but unhappily, very few members of the public can enjoy those views. And poor old Lady Grey Drive essentially has morphed into being essentially a parking lot for employees who work in the area. There was also a connection between Nepean Point and Major's Hill Park, which, as you know, was the first public park in the city. And there was, from the 30s to the 50s, there was this wonderful pedestrian bridge, but in 59, that was taken down. So now you can't cross St. Patrick Street to connect to the park. So we started looking at this quite carefully, and now this whole area has gone from being a more industrial to an institutional cultural neighborhood, a very well-developed neighborhood of Lower Town, the Bywood Market, beautiful Major's Hill Park, and Rideau Canal, Parliament Hill. And what we were very interested in is this white line. How we can integrate this more into the finer grain of the urban scape that we have here and make this connection, and also connect from the city to the river. And what we developed was an idea of three tiers of connectivity. Sussex Drive, extraordinarily important street, Confederation Boulevard, with all the major institutions on it. This red line, we tracked that actually it was quite easy to get and use Lady Grey Drive up until about this point, and then it got somewhat challenging to get around the gallery onto Nepean Point, and then you'd have to bridge over to Major's Hill Park. But if you did all that, you could once again not only connect the larger system, but Rideau to Rideau, which was a very compelling idea. And that would be done at the top of the cliff, and then could there be a riverside walk as well? And then what was very important for us was, how do we actually make those connections to between these tiers? How do we connect through from Sussex and the city and make this much more accessible? You can see here the challenges. This is particularly steep here. This is our building, this is the forecourt, the gallery, and you can see the heights are quite challenging. But there's also, where there's a challenge, there's also a great opportunity. So we did some imagining of what it could possibly be like. So these are just some initial renderings. And what we're looking at here is, you've just crossed over from Nepean Point over to Major's Hill Park, and have just landed. And again, the public can recapture that amazing view of Parliament Hill. This is an idea about how one might cross over and connect between the Pier Point and the park. And then here, when you're actually out on the point, again you have these quite extraordinary views over to Gatineau and back to Parliament Hill. And then further along, looking back to the statue, Alexander Bridge, and making your way to the north. And then a notion of what if we, and I have to say that we worked very, very closely with the NCC and with our neighbors, the Mint and the National Gallery on this. Remember meeting with you, Serge, way back when. And we had meetings with the National Gallery, and everybody was really very, very enthusiastic. It was quite wonderful. And we had meetings with the National Gallery and said, would you mind awfully if we sort of put out this idea that perhaps we could cover up your service yard and have it be a place where it would be a terrace for people to enjoy the river. So this is a notional idea of that. They didn't freak out. but it would be, I don't know if any of you have actually seen the view from there, but it really is so beautiful and west-facing. So that's a notion about how the city might again address this riverside. And I'm very happy to say that this master plan has now been incorporated into the NCC's plan for the capital region, 2017 to 2067. And they've just come out with a competition, design competition, for Nepean Point. So we're thrilled to see that this is already in play, a redesign of that, and hopefully strengthening, again, these connections to the city and perhaps even bridging over to Majors Hill Park. And this is the notion here about how the terrace could fit in the future. So it's very, very exciting. So then we came back to our building design. So having spent actually, I think almost 2 years looking at this in quite a bit of depth and working with the NCC and our neighbors, it became clear to us that our building could actually play a really valuable role as a bridging element and already start as an agent to connect the city to the river. So that was became a very important objective for us, to connect Sussex Drive to the river, and also to presence the GCP for sure on Sussex Drive, but also on the river. So to try and redress the balance, no more backs to the river. This is a new institution, not very old, and so we needed to make sure that it could be a very flexible infrastructure, so it could accommodate how the institution could grow and flourish. And the Dialogue Center was really the signature space and the face to the public, so that was very important for us as well. Universal access, which as everybody who works in with heritage buildings knows, is not an easy thing. And then to optimize the wonderful views to the river as well back as well as back to the city and the forecourt. So we started drawing these diagrams, and what then we this was the first notion to make that connection. And as the river is here, we realized that our architectural moves had to inflect the view back towards the river, north to the river. And this is an overall site plan. This is the 1906 wing, and this is the 1926 wing. So the GCP currently is just a baby, and so they are fitting right now into the old wing, and the newer wing is also being refurbished but being rented out, and the idea is that eventually they can grow into that space. The forecourt is being redone. We have this L of a building here, and we were very interested in actually both keeping the transparency to the building but also capturing some more intimacy in this courtyard and that kind of responding L. And then I'll go through the plans in a minute, but there was a very strong axis and then deflecting the symmetry, and we have this ramp coming up behind. It's also anticipated that this is very flexible and we could have all kinds of outdoor events there as well. So I'm going to walk you through the different seasons, which was very, very important to us. And this is an impression of the courtyard. We have Ipe benches on Aramosa stone, Canadian stone. In the winter, where I think at night in the winter, I think it just looks absolutely beautiful in the public spaces with the snow. So we were very thinking very carefully about the lighting. The spring, we have service berries. The summer, and in the evening. And this is the courtyard under construction from a little while back. And I just want to mention that there was an awful lot of attention paid to the selection of the plants. And Prince Amina was particularly interested, His Highness's brother. And so we worked with a horticulturist here and we selected quite very interesting species, quite unusual but very, very durable. So I'm really looking forward to seeing this in every season. The building had not experienced a lot of love and care in a number of years, and it was left vacant. So our clients did extensive studies and inspections on the exterior walls. What we discovered was the 1926 wing was fine, but the original wing, the 1906 wing, the exterior walls actually were in terrible shape. And the rubble wall that actually was the structural backup for the stone was in extremely bad shape. So there was an awful lot of work that went into rehabilitating and rebuilding that wall. What we did was we installed an entire structural frame in behind the stone and connected the stone wall to it. And we also raked every joint and repointed. So this is now, you'll be happy to know, conforms to the seismic code. You're okay to visit as soon as John opens the doors. So then they stripped out all that stuff from the War Museum and all the asbestos, and we were totally gobsmacked. Most beautiful space emerged. We had no idea. Those of you who visited the War Museum. So here you can see, it's quite interesting. This is the vestibule. This is we kept in place. This is a vault that we eventually kept in place. This was the lobby. And this is the stair elevator which we took out. We even remade all the imposts, so because they were destroyed, and reinstalled those. We discovered the original south wall of the original building, and we've actually exposed part of that stonework now. We reused heritage beams. There was an awful lot of thought, and we worked very, very closely with Barry to figure all this out. And then for the dialogue center, we actually had to remove two columns. And this shows you, this is the dialogue center. So I'm going to show you our renderings and then work in progress. So this is a rendering of the entry vestibule. To provide universal accessibility, there is access to the elevator just off to the left. And we've reinstated a new stone that is very much like the original. And there will be a bead blasted stainless steel rail there, which is very much like the original Manel. And what is completely different is that as you come up the stair, you actually get a view right through to the natural light. As you enter the lobby, we've exposed the existing structure. Off to your right is the dialogue center. Off to your left is the seminar room. And this is the bay window. So you can see the outline of the gallery, and we've installed, we designed a special treatment that I'll talk about to the glass to reflect your view to the north. And this is under work in progress. This shows actually we eventually retained this vault, and we have it floating there, and the view. This is the rendering for the Dialogue Center, and Bruce and I really wanted, thought about this almost like a kind of a pavilion or a tent somehow inside the old building. So we have the simultaneous reading of the old existing building, these are the columns, and then we have this wood which is all acoustic, and again there's a pattern to this that I'll address in a minute. And so that wraps with a wood floor, so we've created a very, we think a really warm, welcoming, accessible dialogue center. And this is it under construction. It can go only get better for you. This is the seminar room, and that is Sir Arthur Doughty's fireplace that we retained, and this under construction. So I wanted to talk about the pattern. So given that this is a global center for pluralism, we had a lot of discussion, but what we were clear on, whatever pattern we selected, both for the bay window and for the wood paneling, for the dialogue center, it could had to be culturally non-specific. So what we did is we said, why don't we look to the building, to its heritage. And it has a really beautiful trefoil pattern, and that's where we based our studies. So we started studying that, and this is what we ended up with. And that allowed us to provide the acoustic insulation and also the warmth of wood. This is in the Dialogue Center. So, this is the facade facing the river. Clearly, it was thought of as back of house. Very little consideration given to it, and this is where the stair was. It doesn't have anything of the kind of handsome tower, the symmetry, and the robustness of the facade facing Sussex. So this seemed to us an ideal place to actually insert the bay window. And this is the rendering of our proposal. We had noted that all the offices on the second and third floor of the archives had copper doors. And so in thinking about it, what we decided to do and proposed in Fibro and our clients agreed was to actually use a glass that has a copper mesh encapsulated in it. And the idea also that we had was that this should be, we angled it as a gesture of almost like an open door, which for us had many, many, many different meanings, all of which seemed very positive. But it also allowed us to have that gesture where we direct the view to the river, and we also enjoyed the sort of adding to the notion of these towers on the rear. This is it at night. This is the pattern for the glazing, and this shows it during the day. So what we did is we did a black frit on the inside. We have the copper mesh, and at night, it becomes quite different, and the play of light, both inside and outside, is pretty extraordinary. This is it being installed. And now you can actually spot a building, and now the building more graciously addresses the river. And then we studied this a lot, the conditions where we actually cut the building, allowing a bit of glass so you actually, as you slip through, you're very much aware of the building. And this is the built, the work in progress. Rendering on the left again, view to the river, and work in progress. And the very nice thing is that when you're up there on the second and third floor, you get really close to the detailing of the building and see it in a way that one can't really appreciate otherwise. And as the light dies, it it takes on a very different character. So we went back across the river, and we were quite pleased, actually. And we think this is a very good beginning, combined with all the other thinking that is going on in the city and with the NCC about this whole precinct now. We think that this is, we see this hopefully as a catalyst of the transformation of this area. And I have a very personal interest in this project. I emigrated to Canada from South Africa in 1974, and I chose to come to Canada because it seemed to me to be a very open and tolerant and diverse society. We are the last country that actually welcomes immigrants at this point in time. When I came to Canada in 74, everyone seemed all hot and bothered about Canadian identity because our neighbors to the south were so clear of theirs. And then John Ralston Saul quite brilliantly put it all in perspective for us. And I think that's what is so important and needed in the world now, is that people are able to embrace difference and complexity. And we as Canadians are particularly comfortable with that, and I think that's also why His Highness approached the government to do the Global Centre for Pluralism here. And we're very, very honoured to have been able to play a small role in the creation of this very, very important institution. And it seems that its opening could not have been more timely than right now. So, thank you very much. Open it up for questions, please. Yes.
Hi, Shirley. Welcome back.
Thank you.
My question is pretty specific on the country of thinking. I was
most fortunate to have a tour this summer of the building under construction. And it's lovely, it's fascinating. Your ideas, I think, are very special and very appropriate. I think the open door, the window is excellent. I love that analogy. The design of the glass with the beautiful copper filigree and the whole thing, you take it up to very clearly say this is like a billboard, it's not part of the original. It seems to have a kind of odd relationship with that cresting on the original building, just at the top. Can you talk about the evolution of that aspect of the design?
Yes, so this was, it was really important to us because it seemed that this, in a way, was not only an analogy for the transformation of a building over a century, but also, in a way, a metaphor for how our country is transformed. We are a very, very different country now than a century ago. So for us it was really important to have that gesture on the exterior and also to address the river. We had a lot of discussions with FIBRO. I have to admit we started out taller because we were looking at the 1926 where the towers were taller. And in the end what we did after a lot of study, we settled on actually the height of the pediment. So it does have a very direct relationship to it, and we set it off from the existing building because we wanted that narrative, that story, to be very, very clear. That we actually have come back a century later, taken out a chunk, and made a clear distinction between the contemporary edition and the existing. And we're also hoping that when you go and visit it, it's really nice actually when you walk in the bay and you kind of see right across the building. that your sort of consciousness of the heritage nature of the building is heightened by being able to see that. So I don't know if that answers it. Please.
I'm wondering whether you were able to do anything with the roof, especially in possibilities of viewpoints and so on. Is it accessible, or would it be accessible? I mean, did you think about what potential there might be? It's flat, I take it. So.
Yes, Bruce and I, whenever we're looking at a renovation of a building, we go up on the roof because the views are incredible from there. They really are. But how long do I need to give you, John, before you've outgrown the second wing and you need an addition on the roof and you call us back? But the reality was, of course, that it is a new institution. It's quite modest to start with. And though it would be quite spectacular, there really was absolutely no need to do that. But left in John's good hands, we'll see. Please.
Thanks. Shirley, when you were talking about re-establishing some, or establishing perhaps for the first time some of the pathway connections and sort of reinventing that abandoned Lady Grey Drive, you talked about discussing it with the NCC, with the Art Gallery, but what about the Mint? Because they would presumably also have to be an important player in any such plan. Are they interested?
Oh, absolutely. We consulted all along with both the Mint and the National Gallery. There have been extensive and ongoing discussions. And this is very much, obviously, evolving, you know, idea. But they've been very, very cooperative. I mean, both the National Gallery and the Mint were very enthusiastic about the opportunities.
Hans Paul Hoping, I'm here for CKCU-FM. I was really kindly reminded and impressed by the earlier remarks regarding the place where we're sitting and standing. Now, while looking at these redesigns and these new outlines, I'm wondering to what extent the project will take into account the Aboriginal heritage, which is, after all, so crucial and central to the history of the country and the national government.
That's a great question. And when we say pluralism, it would definitely include our First Nations. And I did mention that when we look back at the history, this really was a place where Aboriginal peoples passed through and then the settlers came. And the traders, and so it was a place of trading, but there were no, I think it was post-settlement, it was when they started building the military barracks and so on. There weren't any structures that we could find in our research about that. But I think it's a very, very important and an excellent point, because hopefully as this missing link gets developed, you could draw the analogy a little bit with the missing link of it in our history, and I think it would be great if our entire history was taken into account. It is very important. Thanks.
Mentioning that the 1906 wing suffered a lot of loss, the bricks had to be removed with a steel reinforcement to support the structure. Were you able to resalvage some of the brickwork? I know at Gooderham building out in the distillery in Toronto, that was one of the efforts and embroidery for them. You were able to salvage some of the brickwork.
It's all original stone, all original. So it was done very carefully in sections, and we were able to install the steel frame and make the connections back. But it was all done Institute.
Thank you. I noticed in one of the pictures you showed of the building in its early days that the fact there were ceiling fans. I assume you've upgraded the tour facilities, but I also wondered what you've done about environmental considerations, energy efficiency, and things like that in the renovation of this.
Yes, and I think the firstly, the huge investment in rehabbing this structure and reusing it in this adaptive reuse is extremely environmental versus building a new building. And we did as much as we could with the mechanical systems as well in terms of responsible environmental design. But I think we also reused, where we had taken out sections, we reused the existing heritage beams to put in new sections in the floors and so on. So it was a big effort went into that retention and rehabilitation of the existing structure, because really all the you know, heating and cooling and electrical systems, everything was new. So I think that was probably the largest contribution.
Good evening. First of all, I want to begin by thanking you very much for an excellent talk, excellent description. I was especially happy to see the attention paid to the backyard, facing the river, and especially the walkways. And I'm particularly interested in the very lowest one, the one closest to the river. Could you tell us, is that a given? Is that now going to happen? Or is that still in the talking stage?
So I think this is still very much in the twinkle in the eye, in the aspirational stage. And it's wonderful that this is now included in the NCC's 50-year long-term vision for the National Capital Region. But it became clear to us that the red line at the top of the cliffs was probably the more practical path to try and achieve in the first instance. In this area, it's extremely steep, and the slope is, there's a question of stability, so there'll have to be some remedial work done. So it's quite to tackle a path that you can actually get to, and it has to be universally accessible and so on, would take an awful lot of work. So I think what tends to happen with master plans is if you build a little bit of it, then you know people come, they understand the value, and then you build on that and so on. Whether that will ever be done, I'm not sure, because that is probably the highest level of difficulty, that one down at the riverside. So I think we... One more question, if anybody has. Thanks.
An unfair question to you, because you're not running the place, it should really go be addressed to management. We're using this particular room to great advantage tonight. I noticed that the center as such does not now feature such an accommodation. Is it the expectation that Ismaili Imamat will continue to host events of the GCP?
I think that's a good question. Our hope is that, well, first off, as Shirley mentioned, our prime space will house 120 people. But for bigger events, we look forward either to coming back here or possibly to the National Gallery, which has a wonderful auditorium that will take a lot of people. So I think we're looking at, and even Global Affairs has some spaces. So I think the short answer is yes.
So now what happens after the Q&A?
Before I thank the many who have made this evening possible, I'd like to mention a few items to you, if I may. The first is that we are standing in the Ottawa delegation of the Ismaili Imamat, which is the first building in the world that represents the Ismaili Imamat and its institutions. This very fine building was a wonderful gift to the heritage of the National Capital of Canada. Many of us know much about buildings and about landscapes, but we do not always know about the people who inhabit them. And so I have done a little bit of reading, because there is much to read about the Ismailis. And I think the first encouragement that I should share with you is to read about this amazing society that we are privileged to share our great nation with and that they are part of. The second thing that I would like to say is that the Global Center for Pluralism, and I want to underline this, is the center's international headquarters. This is a second gift to the National Capital of Canada that I think is quite extraordinary. We are celebrating this year the 150th anniversary of our country, and so our country is great in many ways, and its capital is important. And so it is important to thank the founder of the Aga Khan Foundation and the founder of the Global Center for Pluralism, His Highness the Aga Khan, for his interest in our capital and in his sustaining a level of intervention in our capital that is contributing very substantially to our heritage in long term and to the greatness of our country. Like pluralism, Heritage Ottawa is rooted in respect and inclusion of buildings as they represent the diversity of our shared and evolving history. The global conservation about diversity can include respect for the identity of cultural expression found in architecture and in our cultural landscapes. These are places of memory, and memory is important. So when we change the name of a street or make any changes in the fabric of our cities, we are changing the memory of a place. And of course, we should shape new memories. Someone asked about First Nations in relation to the Global Center for Pluralism. It is perhaps most fitting that the intangible dimension of this new center, as I understand it, in its views, is actually permitting, I think on the oblique, to see Lac-Limi. Now Lac-Limi, some of you will know, is important Algonquin territory and holds artifacts that are 4,500 years old, possibly more. Some of you will know that that age alone dates them to before the construction of the Egyptian pyramids. And archaeologists always ask me not to say this. They would prefer that I refer to the receding of the Champlain Sea. But I think that in our minds, that says something about the antiquity of culture on this continent and in this country. And of course, the diversity of our society goes back a very long way. Heritage Ottawa appreciates and hopes that every sector and every citizen should be engaged in a dialogue about the built environment in which we live. And certainly we have many people in this room, I'll name Barry Podolsky and Shirley, who have been very active with Heritage Ottawa and with a coalition of so many, and with residents and many, many of you in influencing projects to the good. So, how shall I close? I think I would like to start by thanking you, the participants, for being here this evening and defying the weather and all kinds of challenges to hear about this remarkable project, and we appreciate your presence. It means a lot to us in organizing these events. I also would like to thank the personnel of the Center, of the Global Center for Pluralism, in particular, if I may underline Alana Dunbar and Kalina Elwan, with whom I had a personal relationship during the evolution of this event. I, of course, want to thank my colleagues at Heritage Ottawa, in particular, Danielle Jones, where is she? Our great webmaster, collaborated also closely on this event. And of course, this thanks would not be complete without thanking the Secretary General, Mr. McNean, for his support in making this event possible and to the delegation of this meeting, in the delegation of this meeting in the MAC building. And so now I shall thank Shirley Bloomberg for her unwavering discipline, professionalism, and generosity in sharing her knowledge, her experience with us this evening. And I wish to commend you, Shirley, for all the work you do, and really to thank you most sincerely for having given this amazing lecture this evening and for having contributed most amazingly to the heritage of Ottawa. A gentle reminder that our next lecture, the Heritage Ottawa next lecture, will be on March 15th, and will address the construction of the new Visitor Education Centre on Vimy Ridge. You will remember that April 9th marks the 100th anniversary of the Battle of Vimy Ridge, in which so many Canadians gave their lives, 4,000. And I will mention that this year, given the 100th anniversary, this is a special year in France, and a new visitor education center is opening thanks to the collaboration between Veterans Affairs Canada and the Vimy Foundation. So you will hear more about this on March 15th. Thank you. And I think we have until 8:40 to vacate the premises, so between now and then you may chat with each other and catch up, and thank you for being here.